Welcome. So today we're going to talk about the creation of the first world operating system or world network operating system, essentially the rise of Ethereum, which some of you or many of you may have already heard about before. But let's take a dive a little bit deeper to see where this came from and where it's going. First of all, you can't talk about Ethereum without talking about their founders. So back in 2013, there was an initial group of founders that kind of came together. First off with Vitalik Buterin, who actually wrote the original white paper. He was a writer for Bitcoin magazine at the time and came up with the idea that, you know, Bitcoin's great, but it's not enough. You need something that people can develop platforms on and applications. And what if you want to be able to do things more than just transfer money around? And so that was really the original concept. And Vitalik is a computer scientist, so he kind of understood that and kind of got that. Well, turns out a lot of other people were thinking the similar lines. So we have Anthony DeLauro, also Charles Hoskinson, Mihai Alisi, and Amir Shetrit. Now, not all these people stayed. In fact, the only one who's still there is Vitalik. Anthony went on because he wanted to have Ethereum be a for-profit, but the rest of the group didn't want to do that. He went on to develop the Jax wallet, which is a very popular wallet program. Charles Hoskinson, who you may or may not have heard of, he actually went on and left Ethereum to actually found Cardano because he understood the limitations of what he was seeing in the Ethereum platform and wanted to start from scratch with some science-based testing. We'll talk later about Cardano at another time. Mihai Alisi was from Cyber Electronics. He was the VP of the Ethereum Foundation. And then Amir, it took forever for me just to even find a picture. Had very little contribution and ended up being asked to leave in 2014. In exchange, they actually added three other people, Joseph Lubin, Dr. Gavin Wood, and Jeffrey Wilkie. So Joseph Lubin also launched the Consensus Incubator, which he runs now, and he's still active in the space. He has electrical engineering, computer science background. Dr. Gavin Wood, maybe you've heard of him. He's actually the founder of Polkadot, which is a competing platform. He actually convinced everybody that he needed to be on this when he wrote the yellow paper and actually developed the first testnet for Ethereum before anybody else. So he actually is very much in the technology sphere as well. Also Jeff Rilke, who is also a programmer. He did the first ICO ever recorded for something called Mastercoin. And then he also coded a Geth version, what he calls it, Geth, that was a mimic to what Dr. Gavin Wood did. And now he founded Grid Games with his brother, and that's kind of what he does now. So really, when you look at all of these founders now, the only one who's still with the Ethereum Foundation and the program is really Vitalik. So he's kind of the one who stands out and is kind of the beacon for Ethereum. So what is Ethereum in general? Some of the primary components, it's a programming language that runs on a network. So it's both a blockchain and a language. Now, they created their own kind of language called Solidity, which gets used most of the time for Ethereum. And there are several books on how to program in Solidity. Turns out now they're moving from just the Solidity and Java, which later came on, to now multilingual. In other words, there's now other languages that can then program on Ethereum. And anything to the right of these arrows is where Ethereum has been moving. And also for ETH 2.0. Now, ETH 2.0, we'll talk a little bit more about this later, has been posed to release for quite a while now. And it looks like it's now, they're suggesting it's going to be 2022 before we actually see ETH 2.0. We'll talk more about that, but it's actually getting away from the consensus mechanism of proof of work to proof of stake. So that's one of the biggest pieces of it. The other thing that's also happened that's changed with Ethereum, it used to be very limited on its transactions per second. So from a scalability standpoint, that's difficult. Instead of what's happened is there's actually several other developers that have been providing what they call layer two solutions on top of the Ethereum blockchain. To get the transactions much, much higher. For example, Polygon is a good example of that. It used to be called Matic, but that's another layer two solutions provider that links up lots of other dApps. Then the issuance is still kind of in the process. It was like 13,000 Ethereum per day. However, they just passed an Ethereum improvement protocol, 1559, and now that's making it to where it's burning ETH transactions, which is toning down the inflationary process of Ethereum to try to target around near 4%. It's not precise because it fluctuates all the time. But then what we've also seen happen is the price of Ethereum has actually gone up because now there's some scarcity built into the system where it's actually burning some Ethereum in the process. It is probably one of the most decentralized proof of work systems. Again, it's supposed to be going to proof of stake in 2022. We'll see what that looks like. And they also have several different token types. So this is where when we talked about tokens before, this is where you can create other types of cryptocurrencies, AVA tokens instead of coins, that can work and live on top of the Ethereum framework. The very first one was the ERC-20 coins. And so there's lots of developers that actually run on ERC-20 coins. There's also the 223 standard, the 721 standard, and the 777 standard. We'll talk about those later on. Now, why was it important with this improvement proposal? Well, the 1559, as you can see here, lowers the effective number of Ethereum that are in circulation. So there's a certain amount that's in circulation now. They're actually, since they turned on the 1559 effect, you can see, at least this was up into the latest number that I had, that over 5,000 Ether has been burnt since what they called the London upgrade. That's the other term for that upgrade. And so the effect of that is actually driving the price of ETH higher, because it's now not just producing and producing and producing. There's actually something that's taking certain ETH out of circulation. The other main thing that's taking ETH out of circulation is people staking their Ethereum into nodes. So how does Ethereum make decisions? Well, there's a governance community. So anyone can propose something. And they usually do this on a GitHub, or even Ethereum Magicians. It's another type of thing where they look at that. And then there's discussion. And they decide, do we want to make this protocol change? Do we not want to make this protocol change? Is it valid? Is it not valid? If there's no objections and they want to take the proposal, then it gets merged in. If there is a lot of issues and something can get rejected, then the core developers have to decide, okay, if we can do this and it's technically sound, how are we going to do this? So then it moves up to the clients implementing a hard fork patch. And if all clients update, then the miners and users update. If that happens and everybody updates, you get a successful, what we call hard fork. If you don't, and you get certain groups that hold out and don't want to do the new upgrade and some do, then you get what we have called a contentious hard fork. And in this case, there was one of the last big ones for Ethereum was when Ethereum Classic split off from the Ethereum that we see now. And that was to reimburse a whole bunch of Ethereum that was ETH that was lost. And so there were those part of the community that think, nope, the code is the rule, the code is law, and we don't want to do anything like that. We don't want to intervene in any way. And then the rest of the Ethereum decided, no, we had a bug, we needed to fix it. So they moved on to do that. Now, if you're really interested in getting involved on the programming side, this class isn't really designed on the programming side so much so that everybody can kind of understand what's going on. However, if you really want to get started in understanding how to build, there's a great website, ethereum.org, where they can get you started on how to build. There's tutorials there. There's even other tutorials that I've got links to here on this slide. DappUniversity.com is another place you can go. There's also some of the resources that I have in the syllabus that you can also look up if you'd rather have a book that you can kind of walk through and learn how to do different types of programming. So again, we are going to proof of stake. That's what Ethereum's goal is. Right now, that's still not quite the case. It's still in testnet mode. So we still have a proof of work system. So what does that look like? There's four main parts. There's a seed, which then gets computed for each block, and then it scans through the block headers up to whatever that seed point is, so it's kind of random. From that seed, one can compute 16 megabyte pseudo-random cache. Like clients will store the cache, and from there they generate a 1 gigabyte data set. From this property, that each item in the data set depends only on a small number of items from the cache. Full clients and miners will store the data set, and it grows fairly linearly with time. So you have to imagine at every node, you actually have to store that data set. Then the mining involves grabbing random slices of the data set and hashing them together. And then verification in that way can be done with much lower memory than, say, like how Bitcoin does everything, where you have to actually have the full blockchain in memory. So the large data set gets updated about every 30,000 blocks. So most of the effort and the energy spent in mining is really to reading that data set, not making the changes to it. For more information on that, you can go to the github.com/Ethereum, and so the link is right there for those who really want to dive down the rabbit hole. Now, why is this important that we move from proof of work to proof of stake? There's been several discussions about it. There's always the energy discussion that why are we using all this processing power? So it also increases processing requirements over time. And particularly with both Bitcoin, Ethereum, and some of those that have fixed problems to solve, more and more people have been upgrading to faster and better processors that are more optimized to solving those problems. So for example, if you try to solve the problem just on your computer on a CPU, it may take you quite a long time, and you're not going to be able to compete with somebody who is using a GPU, which actually can process the problems faster, or an FPGA, which is a free programmable gate array, where you can actually program specifically your chip to solve that problem and not do other things, versus the ASIC, which is an application-specific IC integrated chip. This is where the whole chip is designed just to solve that problem. So those are the fastest mining systems out there. So that's why you see people spending thousands and thousands of dollars on these ASIC miners. And they have an unfair advantage for anybody over who just has a CPU or a GPU or just programmed their own FPGA. The other argument is the electricity consumption. Now, this has been played out more on the public stage with Bitcoin because it's still the big player on proof of work. And so you get these complaints about how much energy is being used. However, you have to ask the question, how much energy is it being used for the value it's giving versus what is it replacing? So you have to consider that. So let's say, for example, if we're considering that Bitcoin is a store of value and it's replacing, say, gold mining, you have to really ask the question and go through the whole process of gold mining. How much energy and how energy intensive is that whole process of gold mining, and what does it do to the environment versus something that is just using electricity and running basically computer algorithms? It turns out that it's far less energy and far less disruptive to the environment just running Bitcoin algorithms than it is actually having a gold mining industry. So, and that's just that analogy. If you're saying it's a store value for assets in general, then you'd have to add up all those other assets that it might displace. With Ethereum, it's a similar argument. However, with Ethereum, it's truly a development platform. So there's not quite an equivalent to something like that. It's a now development platform that's operating across the world. Now, there are transaction fees, which are too high, and they've been too high for a while. So that's another argument for going away from proof of work to proof of stake, and also knocking those gas fees down. And that way, once you do that without having the proof of work and going to proof of stake, you're also going to lower the energy consumption. And for when you consider all the value of the different markets that are riding on this, let's say, for example, like the finance industry, where they're doing derivatives and trading and things like that, compared to like DeFi, which is running on Ethereum. You look at the equivalence and values, and the energy level and the energy use is far less on the Ether network than it would be if you were trying to run all those systems anyway, digitally, like they do with the stock market, and also probably be far more efficient and faster. The other aspect too is we want to increase the decentralization of the network. So this was a big argument that we had heard recently with Bitcoin, until China had basically banned Bitcoin miners from being in the country. That completely diversified where all the miners are. So similarly, the ETH pool mining is actually far more decentralized than Bitcoin. As you can see, kind of a different mining pools here as when this was taken. So all those reasons is why we want to go to proof of stake. Now, it's been proposed for quite a while now. And even as of this recording, it seems like it's going to be going into 2022 instead of 2021. The example of how they were going to do this was something called shard chains. General process, we have validators, people running nodes. They'll stake a portion of their coins. The minimum amount to stake is 32 ETH. And then they will begin validating blocks. And then when they discover a block that should be added to the chain, then the validate is placed with a bet. And if the block gets appended, the validators get rewarded proportional to how much it bet. Now there's accountability as well. If the validator acts maliciously, in other words, they try to not bet anything and they try to get claimed rewards, or if they're offline for too long, then you can actually get slashed and your actual stake can get taken. So this is kind of the carrot and the stick, right? So the accountability is the stick to make sure that everybody's playing fair. Now, some people applaud this. Some people really don't like this because nobody likes the idea of I'm going to stake something, but yet somebody could, let's say if my power went out and my processors went offline running my node, and now all of a sudden all my ETH gets taken because my processors have been offline. So people that want to get into that game, you better have backups, maybe a generator, make sure that you have clean energy and have ways of keeping your nodes running. So that's why you're seeing a little bit of institutionalization of some of these nodes, because the requirements to keeping a clean node running constantly has gotten higher. If you want to learn more about this, I actually have a link down here that you can use even on the PDF of proof of work versus proof of stake. Now, the big reason why Ethereum is such a big deal is, again, it's the first world operating system. It is a development platform that is open source. Anybody can develop on top of it. So instead of having, say, your Microsoft operating system or your Windows operating system, your Linux operating system, or your Mac OS, this is a network OS all across the world. What's cool about that is people are starting to now develop what we call decentralized applications, applications that don't just sit in one spot. They actually keep data across a network. So you can avoid the honeypot effect of having just one program like Facebook that is storing all of your data. And now they're making tons of money off of your data. So that's one of the big arguments of the crypto movement, is that your data should be yours, not some other company's who's making all the lion's share. So if we just take a snapshot of where we are now, so we're in August 21, we have 188.79 million addresses on the ETH network. However, of all those addresses, there's really only 544,500 active addresses, which is a little bit more better example if we're trying to consider Metcalfe's law and maybe putting some value on this, what that actually looks like. Now, as of today as well, according to the state of the DApps, if you go to stateofthedApps.com, there's 2,829 DApps. Now, I don't think all of those are active DApps. I think some of those have been retired, roughly about 800 of those, 900 of those. So the actual apps that are live or active or in development are different than the total that they give here. Now, the number of new DApps is shown in the purple. And so you can see there was a heavy amount of investment and development in late 2017, 2018, when we had the last big bull run. But there's a little bit, it's been going down a little bit there as far as the number of new distributed applications coming online. And it doesn't mean it's going to continue that way. That's just where we are now. All right, so that gives you a good sense, at least a good baseline idea of what Ethereum is and how it works. We will be looking at some other alternatives to Ethereum because there are some competitors out there, as we showed in the beginning, some of the founders, Hoskin and Dr. Gavin Woods, both have competing projects for developers to go to. All right, that's it for today. Thank you so much, and I'll see you in class.